day today. I was wondering if the early church are Filipinos. Because I look at Acts chapter 2, verses 42 to 47, I found out that every time that they will gather together, there's always food. There is always, how do you call it? I remember one of, I think Pastor Manuel Morales, when he visited us and he started asking, is your church every time you have a Sunday worship, there's always food? I told him that usually we have food. If we don't have, Family Sunday, which everybody will be bringing food. But after worship, we have some cookies and a sandwich is downstairs. So I realized that food, it's so biblical that after worship there is food. Today I'm going to share with you that in house to house, meetings in homes, there is food and there is prayer. Please open your Bible with me in the book of Acts chapter 2 verses 42. In the book of Acts, So the book of Acts is what? The story of the early church as Jesus' disciples carried the gospel to different parts of the world. Now Acts and Luke were written by a medical doctor, Dr. Luke. Now some manuscript, they call this book as the Acts of the Apostles. Now this book is written to one of the sons of here. No, I'm just kidding. This book is written to Theophilus to represent an orderly account of historical facts of Theophilus. That is in Luke chapter 1 verses 1 to 4. Basically, the book is written to confirm that the faith of believers, it is the history of the apostles and covers about 30 years of the early church. So if you talk about the book of Acts has been written for past 30 years during the early church. The text we are going to look at is how the early church was started. If you look at your Bible in chapter 2, verses 14 to 40, here Peter was giving a sermon to the crowd. And then in verse 41, if you look at the in verse 41, chapter 2, what happened there? In verse 41, the lots of people who accepted the Lord Jesus Christ and they were baptized, how many people? 3,000 people. Wow! I can't imagine how the pastor or Peter baptized the 3,000 people. How would you imagine that? Boom, boom, boom. 3,000 people. Now, after they have been saved, what is next to them? Now that they've been saved, they believe Jesus Christ as the personal Lord and Savior, what is next? Last Sunday I mentioned to you that they continually meet at homes. Last Sunday I mentioned that in the homes there is devotion. They are devoted to God's word. And second, they are devoted to fellowship. Oh, somebody forgot the main points or something. Today, I'm going to share with you that in the group meeting, that met at home, there is okay? So remember, when I ask you next Sunday, what's the midpoint? Is there is?
Food and prayer.
Okay. So in the homes, there is food and there is prayer. Okay. Look at verse 42. In verse 42, you will see the praise what? Breaking of bread. Now, breaking of bread literally means what? Fellowship meals. Now, in the context of the temple of fellowship or the temple gathering, usually the early church, they're going to have food. After that would be a dinner, that would be a breakfast. After that, they're going to have a communion. So they have first a fellowship on the meal, so regular table, and then they're going to have a fellowship on the Lord's table. So imagine every Sunday they have the regular table for meals, and they have the Lord's table. Now usually verse 42, most of the Bible scholars, they were saying the breaking of the bread here is not for dinner or meals, but this is about the Lord's table. Because of that, I'm going to jump on verse 46. I want you to look at on verse 46. In order to refer and confirm that there is lack of eating in the home. Look at verse 46b. It says, what? They broke bread in their homes and eat together. And with glad and sincere hearts. How would you eat when in a pool of gladness? You should be eating even though the food you don't like, but you need to eat it with gladness. How would you eat that? I don't know, I can imagine my kids said, Dulce is my favorite vegetable is my ampalaya. And then blessing Kabis, she tried to give them this ampalaya, and you could just imagine the face of blessing Kabis. But the word of God says you need, you know, the early church, when they eat together, they eat it with gladness and sincere hearts. So when you gather together, when you have this fellowship during your Bible study, even though you don't like the food, but you need to smile, because what the Word of God says, you need to eat it with gladness. Okay? So there was an ancient custom in Palestine, I think Mahir could testify this. This is also biblical in Jeremiah chapter 16, verse 7, as well as in Lamentations chapter 4, verse 4. The breaking of bread, when they, instead of slicing the bread, they need to break it with their hands. Now, what's the purpose? Why not just cut, use the knife, cut it? There is a purpose in it. As they will break it, with the host, whoever hosting the meeting or the meal or the fellowship meal, it is the head of the home who would break the bread. As he will break the bread, he is going to take some part of those bread and give it to those who are in the table. He is now initiating the host of the home that you are part now of my family and you are welcome to my home. Okay? So, I don't know if we could practice this, but we have all those, health issues about, you know, hands, and maybe we'll say, Pastor, maybe we could just use the, maybe wearing a gloves, I would say. So, here, again, breaking of bread. So, this breaking of bread is simply what? A fellowship meal. This could be an ordinary family meals or special meals with guests. So the breaking of bread is simply initiates the sharing of the main course and every meal as a believing community of Christ. So the reason that we share of having these fellowship meals because we belong to a community of Jesus Christ. Here is Luke. He is commanding Theophilus that the new believers of Christ is not enough just to come to church during Sunday. Luke is exhorting the Theophilus that they need, if they become part of a bigger group, they must be part of the smaller group which is meeting at home. Today, the Word of God says, what there is breaking of bread, it simply means that there is fellowship of every believer that should happen, of course, in a bigger family, but there is also a smaller family which is meeting at homes. But let me give you here a joke. Mr. and Mrs. Wilson, they reach to the airport just on time to make the flight. And Mrs. Wilson said, I wish that we brought the piano with us. And the husband just like, what? Why on earth would you bring a piano in this trip? Now, of course, because that's where the ticket, I put it on the top of the piano. Breaking bread or fellowship meals is our ticket. It's our ticket to know more each other. When you sit down on the table, it's not just about the meals. It is about what? Of knowing each other who is on the table. So there is a meal, say that. And verse 42, let's go back to verse 42. What it says there? The word prayer, in Greek word, prayer is a noun form. In Greek word, which is physikomai, which is related to a Greek word of prayer, which is ekomai. Now prayer becomes what an action word. So here. So the word prayer, it is a noun. But this word prayer, because this noun is related, it means that the word, the noun word, it will not function without relating to the verb. So this word now, prayer, it does not remain as a noun, it becomes an action word. So now, prayer now it becomes to pray, to speak, to commune with God. So now the word here, prayer, it means that you don't just wait, when are you going to pray? You need to walk intentionally to pray. If you're so tired, you want to pray. But remember, prayer is not a noun. Prayer is an action word. What does it mean? You need to stand up in your bed and start praying, because the way the prayer is not a noun anymore, it becomes an action word. Every church and every believer, they could not just wait when to pray. You need to engage. You need to speak with God and ask God for it. In a meeting, at homes, or in a smaller group, there is more intimate. It comes on praying when there is a smaller group. No, prayer in a smaller crowd, it is more what? Personal. There is more what? Honesty, transparency. You could pray especially in the needs of the person. You could be personal in your prayer when in a smaller crowd. Not only that, the more you will know the person. Imagine as I'm going to go back to the sitting on the table, having this meal fellowship. Imagine as you would share each other what's going on. You'll be able to know to the person that you're talking with. And the problem of praying that is not specific. Have you prayed that, Lord, would you give me this? And sometimes we would even say, Lord, will you forgive me? It becomes, what's the problem of praying that is not specific? Or that is so generalized? That we ourselves, we don't know that God has really answered the prayer. When we pray, we need to be specific. So when we come to the Lord in prayer, in a smaller group, we must be personal and specific in our prayer. Because I know and I understand you don't want to open up some of those feelings that you keep holding on. And that's why when you give your prayer request, it is just so broad. It is just so general. But how could God answer your prayer? Let me give another joke to you. Before the takeoff, a flight attendant made an announcement to the passengers, please let me know if you would like some gum before takeoff. It will prevent your ears from bursting as we climb. Now, after the flight, everyone disembarked except for one man. Do you need assistance, sir? The attendant asked him. And he said, can you speak up? He shouted, he could not hear. I can hear you with all this gum in my ears. It is like putting a gum in our ears that you cannot hear what God's speaking with us. I believe the small group meetings at home, it is so instrumental to speak that God would speak to us. God would use those people in your group to tell you the truth. Now sometimes it hurts, but that is how God speaks with you in your group. Now sometimes we don't want to attend a small group because we don't want to be checked. It's just like putting a gum in your ears, you don't want to listen. One of the saying, he says, don't accuse God that God did not answer your prayer, knowing that you did not even open your Bible. Sometimes we accuse God that he did not speak to us. How would God speak that your Bible is closed? Now, how can we apply this to today? My friend, we're living in a society that is so impersonal. Because our society is so impersonal, the way we communicate with each other, we have what? Telephone, we have cell phone, Facebook Messenger, we have Twitter, we have email. Huh?
Viber?
I don't know.
Viber.
So now, you don't need to see face to face in order to talk. You can talk to somebody miles away without even seeing the person, but you could hear his or her voice. What happened now? We eliminate the power of touching the person. You could just tap on his or her arm or in her shoulder. That person could receive encouragement. We don't want to see each other anymore because we could just call. We could just email. We could just text you. You don't need to see me. There is no physical encouragement that is going on in our society today. This society is very impersonal. Not only that, we become a technology savvy. We become a technology savvy. And imagine the husband and wife keeping the date and during the daytime, what happened? Somebody is calling on somebody. Somebody is looking on the Facebook. There may be some message from somebody. Even in a marriage, it becomes so very impersonal. In the family, it becomes very impersonal. When you come home, it sounds like nobody inside the house, because the kids, they're just playing the iPad in their own rooms and they ignore that their parents is home. Family is very impersonal today. Not only that, our society today become a task-oriented rather than a personal-oriented. When I give you a responsibility, when your company will give you a responsibility, whether you like it or not, if you are sick or not, you need to fulfill that goal, that quota, you need to fulfill that or else you're fired. That's how impersonal society today. Not only that, we become a busy culture. Imagine this guy. We want to do everything we can. We become so busy of so many things. At the end of the day, you achieve nothing. Doing this in all these things, we could not spend time anymore with our family, with our kids, even with our friends. Even the church itself becomes impersonal. When you come into church, you just say hi, hello, and that's it. And that's why I really appreciate the wisdom behind why God, He wants us to be part of a bigger crowd, of a house, of a temple. But God wants us to be part also of a smaller group where there is personal going on inside of that meeting. And that's why if you're just part of a bigger church, it's just very impersonal. But when as you come to the meeting at home, you would know each other. You would know that the struggles you are facing, somebody have more struggles than you have. That's why it is so important. Paul is saying to the Luke is saying to the early Christians, yes, you are part of the temple, but you need to be part also of the meetings that is going on at home. Last joke. This is a conversation of a he and she. He said, I got this great, it's a conversation of, as I mentioned, he and she. He said, I got this great new hearing aid from the other day. And she said, are you wearing it now? Yes, I am wearing it. Cost me $4,000. It is top of the line. And then she asked this, what kind is it? And he answered, it's 1230. Do you get it?
Yeah.
It's top of the line. The kind of hearing aid. And he asked, as she asked, what kind is it? And he answered, it's 1230. What kind is it? It is not 1230. It is a small group that meet at homes. Do you hear me? There is a place that we could be personal and pray one another. But there is a place that we could be personal where you could bring your food. It doesn't matter what kind of food, as long as you could bring food and have fellowship on the table. The place that I'm referring is the place of Bible study group that is to be done or that has been doing, it's been going on now in the homes. The logic why breaking the bread or fellowship meals is so important and developing relationship. When you're eating food, what happened? When you're eating food, your mind is trying to relax. You know, our mind is so secretive of so many things. We always guard what is secret that belongs only to us. So our mind is putting this wall or this protection that nobody would know. As you come to the table, your mind is trying to relax and try to taste how tasty the food that is on the table. The mind now is focused on the food, not on protecting the secret that he has. As you come on the table, without knowingly, the person would mention about the struggles that he is facing. Now I realize how illogical it is that after worship, there is a food fellowship downstairs. Because this is the time that unknowingly, as you will talk to the person, as you will talk to the person, he will just open up the struggles that he's facing. And that's why a food fellowship, it is so important. Think about this. An attendee of this church that is not part of the meeting that meet at homes. Again, I want you to think about this. Maybe this person carrying a heavy load. Maybe that person is carrying the challenges, his problems, maybe hurts that he is carrying on her shoulder. But he could not find a place where he could unload all those problems and struggles that he is carrying on him. He could not find a place that is secure. What happened to that person? Because he could not find anybody, he could not find a book that he could share. He kept carrying that heavy load that is in him. And he don't know that this load that he is carrying from day to day, it kills him in so many ways. It kills his marriage. It kills his family. It kills his walk with the Lord. My friend, the burden that we're carrying from day to day, we need to unload. And I tell you, the best place to unload that is where? In our small group of people that is meeting at home. My friend, I want you to read this. What? You need to unload those things that you have done, what? In the dark. To the people who are in the light. By doing that, you have been lightened. You will. I challenge you to those who don't have a group, be part of the group that is meeting at homes and unload your burden. Don't be choosy. Those people in the group, they are sinners as well, but they are forgiven. Those people in the group, they are not perfect. But the good thing is, they are trying to make Christ as the epicenter of their life. Those people in the group, God is still working at them. But at least you could find a group that will love you and care for you. My friend, again, if you don't have a group, I challenge you to be part of the group. But if you have a group, but you are very inconsistent and unfaithful of your group, I would like to challenge you, please be faithful and be inconsistent. Be consistent with your group. You could not have the full benefits when you are just a full time. Who is working in a part time? You don't have the benefits. Right? Sometimes we want to be a part time Christian and we want the full benefits. It doesn't work. Be a full time Christian and God, you will receive a benefit from the Lord. Let me conclude this message. When God created Adam and Eve, when God created Adam, Adam was not so lonely. Maybe Adam could see the rabbit The two rabbits are talking each other. The two lions are talking each other, but he has nobody to talk with. God is concerned with Adam. He created him from his own bones. Now, not just only he created Eve, from Adam and Eve, there are two individuals who come out from them. Who is that? Cain and Abel. Now what happened? They become a one big family. God have designed the family. Because family, he knows exactly that family brings laughter, joy, encouragement, strength, and fulfillment. My friend, when I was born in this world, God has put me to Mr. and Melissio Dabalos. He wants me to be part of that family, that I could receive care and love. When you were born again, God has put you into a spiritual family so that what? So that you will experience care and love. You could not just be alone, because God has created you, God has intended you to be part of the family. You could not just say, I want to be on my own, I can survive in my own. My friend, you are not created that way. God has created you to be part of the family. Or else, if you're isolated by yourself, Satan could easily attack you and you could easily give up of your faith. Again, this is how God designed the Church of Jesus Christ. We're part of the bigger family and part of the smaller family that meet at home. I believe you have no big family, but I hope everybody has a smaller family. Let me conclude this with an illustration. Grow in your walk with the Lord. If you remove that person, You are removing the oxygen that he needs to breathe on. And God did not design us to be isolated. God designed us to be part of the group so that we could be with each other, so that we could survive each other. There is strength in the unity. But if we are not part of that group, we remove the oxygen that we could breathe. Condemnation, but love and care and encouragement. Lord, I pray, Lord, for those individuals here are not part of the group. Father, would you encourage this congregation, whoever that person, would you use that person, Lord, to be a tool, to be instrument of yours, to bring that oxygen in his spiritual life that he could breathe on again. Father, thank you for speaking to us. In Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you all.